Today we're going to go back in time in order to look at the foundation of modern genetics. And this is Mendelian genetics. So far, we've seen how DNA self-replicates. It's transcribed and translated, so we get proteins. We looked at the pattern of inheritance during cell division in mitosis and in the formation of gametes for meiosis. Today we're going to look at how genetics are inherited within families. Now, again, in the past, there were various different models of inheritance. We had the notion of acquired characteristics that were most clearly explicated by Lamarck, but this was also what Aristotle and people like Hippocrates thought as well, that through use and disuse, traits can be modified and that they would be passed on. But we know that's not right. Now, in the 19th century, people said, okay, right, there's pre-existing forms, they get passed on. But in conceptualizing inheritance, people thought that inheritance would inevitably blend together differences between individuals. So here's a simple schematic for this notion of blending inheritance. So you might have a number of couples. And so in one case, somebody who's like bright red marries somebody who's white. You have a couple of people who are red in the particular trait. That in the next generation, these are going to retain the red, the bright red, but these are going to be in the middle. Okay, so instead of being red or white, they're going to be pink. But eventually they breed with each other, and then you get darker pink, and then everybody in the population would be pretty much the same. Okay, so you have the idea that offspring would always be intermediate to their parents, and the descendants then would eventually become uniform. Now, if that was true, there'd be almost no variation in the population. Variation would essentially disappear. Evolution would be impossible because generation after generation, everybody's the same because they've all blended their bits of inheritance together. But this is wrong. And we understand now how genetics works and can continuously generate variation through time through the work of this man, Gregor Mendel, who lived from 1822 to 1884. He attended the University of Vienna. He took orders in an Augustinian monastery. And as a monk, he devoted a lot of his life studying the heredity of peas, you know, peas like on a plate. And so he did very careful breeding experiments in the garden of the monastery over this 8-year period. And one of the horrible ironies for a lot of people's understanding of the development of modern evolutionary thought, nobody knew about his work for 30 odd years. So Darwin, as he grew old, he was trying to understand how genetics could possibly work so that you could have evolution by natural selection. A lot of other geneticists were puzzling out what was going on. Mendel had sorted it out by the 1860s, but nobody knew about it till 1901. But this is a study organism, the pea, the green pea, and he's interested in variants in different characteristics. So whether they're peas are round or they're flat, the pods are green or they're yellow. And he was very careful in tracking how these traits passed on from one generation to the next. So Mendel's work consisted of a series of controlled breeding experiments. And the extraordinary insights he got depended on this. He would deliberately cross plants with known phenotypes, so physical appearance, to infer genotypes, their genetic composition. So he's working backwards from physical characteristics to infer about the underlying genetics. To do this, he would very carefully control which flower pollinated another. And so here we have two different plants, one with white flowers, this one with purple flowers. And to ensure that the offspring of this plant had a particular ancestry, he would use a paintbrush and collect pollen from the white flower and then brush it on a purple flower. And then after the pollination had taken place, he would snip it off so it couldn't mate with anything else. So he first controls the breeding. He decides who's going to be the partner. And then he allows the plant to mature, the seeds to mature. And he saves the seeds, okay? He goes and he plants the seeds, and then he looks at the offspring, okay? Now, in this particular case, he's got pollen from a white flower, fertilizing the seeds of a purple plant. As the seeds mature, all the offspring now have purple flowers. So he's tracking these traits from one generation to the next. So here we have, first, the key to this is that he developed separate lines, breeding lines. He called these true breeders, okay? And so a true breeding plant is if you self-fertilize them. So you take your little paintbrush and make sure that the only pollen getting on the flower to fertilize its seeds comes from that plant itself, okay? And then he's carefully protecting it. So there's no pollen from anybody else can come in, only self-pollinating. And if you do this generation after generation, save the seeds, self-fertilize the offspring, save the seeds, self-fertilize the offspring, save the seeds. Generation after generation, they're always purple, and that's a true breeding purple lineage. Does it again with white flowers, self-pollinating, only producing white-flowered offspring, generation after generation, so they're pure breeders. Okay, so they've gone through this period of self-fertilization or inbreeding, and now we're going to outcross them. So here we have our true breeding parents, one purple and one white, fertilizing each other. And then the first offspring of these are hybrids, and it's called the F1 generation. And this is a term that's really useful to remember, the F1 generation. It's the first generation of offspring in one of these controlled breeding experiments. And we're going to look at the phenotype. The physical characteristic is that all these hybrids have the same phenotype. They're all purple, okay? Then we're going to take two of these F1s and cross them and look at the characteristics of their offspring. And what he discovered that really has profound importance for everything he did is that even though these are all now purple, if he crosses two of these hybrids, you then get white flowers again. You get white flowers as well as purple flowers, but there's a characteristic ratio here. So of the nearly 1,000 plants that are produced by crossing these F1s, these F2 generations, so the second offspring of descendants here, you have a ratio of 3 purple to 1 white. This trait reappeared. It was gone in the F1 generation. Now it's back again. Okay? And so he did this finding a particular ratio, not just for this, but any number of traits. So he then decided that there are certain traits that we'll call dominant and other traits that are recessive. The dominant would be the only trait you'd see in the F1 generation. Okay? But when you cross two of these F1s, you're then going to have a ratio in the F2 of about 3 to 1, with that dominant trait being more common and the recessive trait being rare. So we saw that first with the example of flower color. And in that first case, there were 705 descendants for every 224 white ones, so 705 purple to 224 white. And so he found the same kind of thing would happen if we looked at where the flower is on the stem. If it's in the middle of the stem or out at the tip, this is the dominant trait. So if you have pure breeding, then the F1, they'll all have this mid-stem flower. But in the F2, you get the 3-to-1 ratio again. 650 mid-stem, 200 at the end. Same for seed color, seed shape, pod color, stem length. Always, this would be the only trait you'd see in the F1 generation, so that's the dominant trait. But you cross two of these F1s for that particular trait. In the F2 generation, now we get this F2 3-to-1 ratio. Okay? So, what Mendel showed in these experiments is that these variants are not blended. Traits reappear from one generation to the next, but in a consistent manner, in this case, a 3-to-1 ratio.